security forces moved in to remove the body from the Dundalk Road.
Claimed she'd been working as an informer for the police for 2 years.
Again, the dead man was naked. His body lay by the roadside under a plastic sheet.
Local people reported hearing a number of shots before discovering the body.
People called to the scene said it appeared the man had been shot in the head shortly before being dumped. The dead man.
The IRA's penalty for informing is death. In the last 25 years, they've killed almost 50 alleged informers. It's a fate only a very few escape. One of those who did get away is now in hiding outside Northern Ireland.
I'm dealing with a very, very, professional organisation. The IRA have got the manpower, they've got the ability, they've got the people who will quite, without doubt, come over and they would shoot you as quick as they would look at you.
Martin McGartland saved dozens of lives working undercover in the IRA. But now he fears for his own life. For 5 years he's been in hiding outside Northern Ireland. Now he's getting ready to return home, and he's taking no chances. He's hoping the IRA will have forgotten what he looks like. But he knows that's probably wishful thinking, so he's disguising his appearance.
I have as much right to live in Belfast as Gerry Adams has, or anybody else. And what I'm saying to you is, I'm having to sneak into my own country because the crime that I committed, I saved people from getting killed.
Today, Martin McGartland is returning to Northern Ireland to appear in court. He'll challenge a decision that he's not eligible for compensation for injuries he sustained escaping from the IRA. The Northern Ireland office says he's not entitled to any money because he was a member of an illegal organisation.
I worked for the special branch for 4 years, very, very successful. One of the, probably, I'd say I was in the top five agents at that particular time in the whole of Northern Ireland. And I saved as many people as I possibly could. I wasn't looking for no medals, I wasn't looking for nothing. All I wanted was to make sure that I was helping people in some way. This is very, very stressful for me, knowing that I have to go back over there. It could cost me my life by going back there. I'm in a position where I would like to think that I helped the Northern Ireland office out, I mean, in a big way, over the period of time I was working for the special branch. And the fact that they're willing to, like, put my life at risk by asking me to go back over and stand in a court in Ireland, it's ridiculous. It should never be allowed to happen.
Martin McGartland will be called on in court to recount his years in the IRA working for the police. It was a career which began in West Belfast, where he says he was recruited at the age of 17.
And I was like a typical kid in Belfast from the book, getting into like little bits and pieces and trouble, and that's basically how I first got involved.
At first, the police told him to gather low-level intelligence on people in Ballymurphy. But in 1989, he claims they asked him to go one step further.
They just told me, look, if you join the IRA, we will make sure, obviously, we'll make sure you're in a position where you won't get arrested and stuff, which is right, because, I've always made it quite clear, I haven't got no sympathies with the IRA. And I can honestly say, sitting here now, that I would never, ever join the IRA had I not ever met the police.
Martin McGartland had mixed motives in agreeing to infiltrate the IRA. There was money involved. He says he was paid around £20,000 a year. For a working-class teenager from Ballymurphy, it was very good money. But there was more to it than that. Being a police agent made him feel important.
It was like exciting at the very, very start. But whenever you start getting yourself in a position where you're passing on information, that's like seizing weapons and explosives, it becomes more like professional then. You're in a position where you're going, yes, this is deadly serious, it isn't a joke no more. A lot of people pointed out to me, you were only an agent because you were getting money. That is complete nonsense. I was working for the police because I was very young, and you could probably say at the very start I didn't really realize what I was getting myself into. And then whenever it hit me what I was doing, right, it was too late. I had been, hooked.
It wasn't easy to join the IRA. He first had to gain credibility amongst its members.
I just started socialising with the right people and stuff. Obviously, I mean, it didn't just happen like within a couple of days. It was a long time. And I just more or less done what I was told and done things the way I was told to do it, and it all just fell into place.
Once he had infiltrated the IRA, Martin McGartland kept in regular contact with Special Branch. Known as Agent Carroll, he would meet his handlers when he had information to pass on.
The very start, I didn't see a lot of him. It wasn't until obviously it was passing on like high-grade information. I was seeing him maybe 3-4 times a week, maybe even daily. But it takes a long time before you get into a position like that.
It was vital that Martin McGartland maintained his cover. He would go to unusual lengths to avoid suspicion.
I used to always get in David a bar with him, I mean, the police and stuff, and a bit of fighting and all of them in the street and all, but I'm saying that was just obviously part of, like, obviously making people see that you're on the side of the IRA.
His main job in the IRA was as a driver, moving guns and explosives from one safe house to another. The frequent contact he had with IRA weapons proved indispensable to the RUC.
We were in dumps, safe hidden places, and I had like full access to them. Just go collect them late at night, take them away, bring them back again earlier in the morning. I used to just take them into Castlereagh and stuff, get them bugged in and put them back in into circulation again so they can be followed.
But it was when he became privy to the planning of IRA operations that he was most effective as an agent. He believes the information he passed on saved up to 50 lives.
There was like loads of stuff that I was actually involved in. I mean, from bombings, undercar booby traps that I foiled, to actual shootings or just actual big bombings itself. One particular one in Rathcoole, when there was two IUC men walking around the area. And the IRA planned to send two gunmen up and walk behind them and shoot the two of them. The IRA thought that not only would it be a good result because it can kill two IUC men walking around, but also it would be a bit of a setback for like the loyalist death squads because of the fact that the IRA can walk into one of their estates and shoot people in it. There was another one with a very high ranking, I think he was a divisional commander from Hillsborough, who was in the IUC, and a gunman was going to lie in his backyard with an AK-47. And more or less fire 30 rounds.
Today, live with Phillips!
He also claims he stopped a plan to target police officers on duty at a Radio 1 roadshow in Portrush.
The IRA were going to put a bomb inside, conceded inside a ghetto blaster, and they were going to leave the actual bomb under the police car. And I notified the Special Branch about that. Just, I mean, the IRA just more or less. Any opportunity where there's a possibility of a result.
The sensitivity and risks involved in being an agent meant only a handful of people in the Special Branch knew of Martin McGartland's existence. Even now, the police still refuse officially to confirm he worked for them.
That's three saves against us, lads.
Perhaps an unlikely ally is a community worker from the Loyalist Shankill Road. Jack McKee is one of the few people to speak up on Martin McGartland's behalf. He's convinced McGartland's actions prevented many deaths, including those of a church worker and a loyalist paramilitary in the early 90s.
When I approached these people, they confirmed to me that the RUC approached them in those years and had warned them that the IRA were out to kill them. They didn't know who had passed that information on to the police, but they did know that it came to them from someone who was operating within the IRA at the time. And Martin couldn't have given me that information had he not have been the person to have initially informed the police of those activities.
But there was one IRA attack Martin McGartland failed to stop. An off-duty soldier, Tony Harrison, was shot dead in East Belfast as he visited his girlfriend. McGartland says he did warn the IUC, but didn't know exactly who the target was. On the day, he says he was ordered to drive the killers and had no opportunity to contact Special Branch. The police did investigate his role, but no charges were ever brought.
I and a lot of people and I can't stress this enough, tell you, we completely done everything in our power to try and stop that man from getting killed. And the fact that I wasn't prosecuted for anything, and the fact that I'm still sitting here now, means that someone behind the scenes have explained my full background.
Those who argue that because he was driving the car, he should be accused of being accessory to murder, probably don't take into account the perhaps 40 lives which have been saved, don't take into account what we've been told about his efforts to try to alert people to the attack that was going to take place on a soldier. I think that because people aren't always successful, doesn't mean to say that what they're doing is on balance wrong.
We all like to think that we would have done differently. We all would, like to think that had I been the person driving the car, driven them into some police station, or I would have driven off and left them standing whenever they got out of the car. But that's easy said when you're sitting in a room like this.
The IRA had become increasingly wary of Martin McGartland. Someone was passing details of planned attacks to the police, and he was the chief suspect. He was summoned to Connolly House, the headquarters of Sinn Féin. But before he went, he met his handlers.
A lot of people obviously got arrested and stuff over the months prior to that. And we were very suspicious, and obviously something was going to happen. And maybe this was more or less the call that I was expecting. So we come up with a plan that obviously suited myself and the special branch, and I was told that obviously to go ahead with the meeting and stuff, and their job was to keep a close eye on me, different ways that we're going to do it. And if I did have to get taken from the Sinn Féin centre, which we thought would happen, they would be very, very close by.
The RUC's concern for their agents' welfare was well founded. The man who had ordered the meeting was the IRA's head of discipline. When Martin McGartland arrived at Connolly House, he was met by two other men. They told him the meeting was to be held at a different location and they would drive him there. An attempt by the police to follow the car was to prove unsuccessful.
I got in a car and they broke a couple of red lights and stuff, and obviously people who were trying to follow me maybe couldn't, they didn't have an advantage. We drove to an estate about 4 or 5 miles away from Connolly House. It was up in the Twinbrook estate. I was brought into a flat. Very, very top of the flats. It was about 30, 40 feet high. I didn't even get a chance to sit down, and one of them turned around and says, "Right, Marty, provisional IRA, you're under arrest." These people had us at gunpoint. They just kept basically saying, "Don't try nothing, don't try nothing." They put me on the floor, took shoes off, tied us up and stuff, with my laces, and put us on a settee, face down with a blanket over the back of my head. Now that's when I started panicking, because I says to myself, these people could have, probably taken over this house. They could very easily shoot me here, and just walk out and get their flat cleaned up and stuff, and get my body moved. I was waiting on, lights going out type thing, just black darkness, dead. Then I asked to kind of go to the toilet. So one of them came along and untied my hands, but my feet were still tied. So I hopped in, and when I went in, the bath had been filled up with water. Now when I seen that, I says, obviously these are going to use this for their torture tactics, putting people's head in the water until they get the drowning effect and pulling them back out again. And if they're not telling them what they want, they're back in again. They were in the kitchen, and I hopped back to the wall, and I just says to myself, these people are going to kill me here. There's nothing more certain than that. And I says, if I don't get out of here now, well, I've got the opportunity. I'm never going to get out. And if I didn't jump out the window, I mean, I was dead. So I just run across the sitting room, hop on, and jump through the window.
Concussed and bleeding, Martin McGartland was taken to hospital before his captors could reach him, then transferred to Palace Barracks. There he was debriefed before being flown out of Northern Ireland. While Martin McGartland embarked on a new life, the two men he claims abducted him went on to appear publicly in the company of Gerry Adams.
I have seen Jim McCarthy and Chico Hamilton in the last elections that Sinn Féin had there whenever they got the 15.5% vote. They were bodyguarding Gerry Adams and they were in the photograph in the photo call for Sinn Féin on the City Hall, and they were starting smiling and stuff.
Both men identified by McGartland have prison records. In 1977, Jim McCarthy was sentenced to 5 years for possession of firearms and ammunition. Paul Chico Hamilton was jailed for 12 years in 1979 for the attempted murder of an army major. In July, the men were named in the House of Commons.
The people I named in the earlier motion were Jim McCarthy and Paul Hamilton, the people who are commonly believed to have taken Martin McGartland to the flat in the Twinbrook estate, the ones who prepared him for the torture team, the interrogators, and the murderers, the killers, to come along. If I've named the wrong people, I hope that Mr. McCarthy and Mr. Hamilton will write to me and tell me. They haven't so far.
The reality of what the IRA are capable of is never far from Martin McGartland's thoughts. After he escaped from Northern Ireland, the RUC provided him with a new home and money to start a new life. He was 21.
It's like being born again and like just living a completely new life. I mean, you're just completely in a position where, if you can imagine moving from wherever you live and actually getting into a new area, meeting new friends and just everything different. I mean, you don't see people who you used to see like every day whenever I was living in Ireland. You never see your family, you never see friends. It's just completely like a whole new life. It's like Dan and like been reincarnated.
Even though he's been given a new life and a new identity, events have shown Martin McGartland needs to remain constantly on his guard.
The Special Branch have told me that they've been to one of my old houses looking for me. And, I mean, I can't go into much detail about that. Obviously, it wouldn't be right, but, I mean, they've been very, very close to one of the houses where I used to live.
Such risks mean he's unable to reveal his true background to anyone.
I know you see, Mum. One says, tell me, he was a Special Branch man, and he says, tell me one day, Martinson, never trust your best friend, because your best friend also has a best friend. And I've took that bit of advice, and it's worked 100%.
Martin McGartland has lost count of the number of times he's moved house since leaving Northern Ireland. In the last year alone, he says he's lived in 6 different places and adopted several different names.
I feel I'm on the run. Even though I work for the Special Branch, I feel as if I'm on the run every day of my life. There's not a day that I don't look behind me. If I see someone following me for more than a couple of 100 yards, I'm very paranoid. I will cut across the street, or I would stand, and I would even stop and wait till the people pass me. I'm very, very paranoid. And you have to be. It's no use running about saying, oh, I've been away for 5 years, I'll just forget. You can't do that. You have to just be realistic.
As a realist, Martin McGartland is meticulous in his security arrangements, taking precautions which are all too familiar in Northern Ireland.
I've been away 5 years, and my security is probably better now than it ever has been. When there was a ceasefire, I was very, very security conscious. I've learnt one thing from the IRA. I never get into a routine, because a routine will get you killed. I'm very security-wise, because obviously, I mean, if you've got good security, you've got a little bit of an advantage. But I'm saying, if the IRA want you, they'll get you, you know what I mean? Now this here is a Browning 9mm automatic, very, very high-powered handgun. And this is something that I have to keep with me for my own security, obviously because of the situation I'm in. I usually have it quite close to, you know what I mean? And if I didn't have it, mean, I don't think I'd be asleep at night times. I mean, it's been 5 years, and obviously, if I didn't have something to protect myself, obviously it wouldn't be worth my while. I have took plenty of training and stuff, and obviously I'm in a position where I can use it quite confidently and stuff, so I'd have to be in like a life or death obviously situation before I'd attempt to use it.
Today's journey back to Northern Ireland is one of the most dangerous things Martin McGartland has ever done. He doesn't have to look very far to be reminded of the risks. There's news of a brutal IRA attack on his younger brother, Joseph.
Just basically saying, obviously, about his injuries and stuff. 2 shattered legs, 5 broken ribs, and 4 pins, holding his like bones together. Also shows you like x-rays and stuff. You can see obviously how many breaks there is and stuff in his legs and stuff. And this is just basically because obviously he had the same surname as me, McGartland. They took him from the house, tied up, carried him, and threw him into a vehicle and drove him to the nearby estate a couple of hundred yards away, where they tied him to a fence and hung him upside down and beat him with scaffolding bars for 15 minutes. Now, these people are completely scum, you know what I mean? 5 men goes in to beat a young kid, he's a kid, you know what I mean? He's only 23 or 24 years of age.
If they're prepared to do that to Joe, even though Joe had done nothing against them or anybody within the area, I think that that sends out a message that if they got their hands on Martin McGartland, that Martin would be dead.
As Martin McGartland departs for Belfast, it's feasible the IRA could be waiting for him. His case for compensation for injuries sustained while escaping from the flat in Twinbrook is being held in an open court.
Thank you very much, thank you.
There's also been some advance publicity of the case.
I'm worried about going to the actual court. Anything can happen, you know what I mean? Anything's possible. I just have to wait and see exactly what's going to happen. I don't really know what the police, what way the police are going to do things. This should never happen in the first place, but obviously it has, and I have to just go. I would rather get me gone back under, like, I mean, different circumstances. I know for a fact I'll be meeting Jack McKee from Fate, and Jack has, like, been completely tremendous amount of help he's given us, and he's given my family a terrible lot of help too. And I'm going to be going to see him, so obviously I don't know what other things they expect.
How you doing, mate? Thank you very much for coming, Jack. Gentlemen.
Glad you made it safe, mate.
Thank you, kid.
I'm in this car here, so we are.
Okay.
Keep going.
Yeah. We'll just put this in the boot.
Yep.
Despite the IUC's refusal to confirm Martin McGartland worked for them, there's a police escort waiting for him at the airport. It seems in practice the IUC take the threat to him seriously enough to give him protection on his journey to court. But that protection has been provided only after Jack McKee wrote to the IUC and the Secretary of State.
The old saying in the past is that as long as you are working for the special branch and your cover's not blown, you're okay, you're one of them, you're one of the boys. But once your cover's blown, you're on your own. And Martin McGartland was to find that out as a reality within his own life.
The case is to be heard at Lisbon Courthouse. It will prove to be a fateful choice of venue.
I was just explaining to the actual judge how hard it was to get into to the IRA. I says, look, these people are a very, very disciplined, professional organisation. And as I was saying that, an explosion went off. The roof nearly came in. And at that particular time, I looked at the actual ceiling, because it was like one of them big glass roofs type things. And I kept speaking.
Martin looked stunned. He looked frightened. We kind of gave him signs in the court for him to remain calm in the witness stand.
I was looking at the judge, but the judge, like, shoulders, like, jumped. He actually jumped with fright.
Our initial reaction or thought was that the provost had found out some way that Martin was in the court and that they'd hit the court.
I looked to the back of the court, over to the bodyguards, the RUC bodyguards, who was, like, looking after me on the day. And I think there was 4 in court, and they all disappeared.
There were several anxious minutes before McGartland was told the bombs had exploded inside Thiepval barracks and not outside the courthouse. Despite the attacks, he stood firm and continued to give evidence. But at the end of the day, he lost the case.
The judge said, in general terms, that his hands were tied. There's a law stating that anyone who has contacts with any terrorist organisation isn't, like, they're not in a position where they can be given compensation. And he just says that he hadn't got no other alternative, only to, like, dismiss the court case.
Martin McGartland refuses to accept defeat. He accuses the government of hypocrisy. He claims they were well aware he was working for Special Branch because they paid him financial incentives.
Them people must have known at that point in time, when they were doing this, that this man must be inside that organisation. But, in other words, what they're saying is, it's very, very well for you to be a member of the IRA, as long as you're passing information on to the police force. But whenever you move away, bugger, you know what I mean? That's what they've said to me.
Back in his new surroundings, Martin McGartland remains adamant he will clear his name. He's considering further legal action, determined to be acknowledged for the lives he saved. It's that need for recognition that has led him to come out of hiding and talk.
It's hard for anybody to imagine, but if you have all these things bottled up and said, you need to speak to somebody. And my only way of speaking was putting, like, a disguise on and talking to the people in Northern Ireland.
Without trying to turn Martin McGartland into a saint, I think what he was doing was in effect saintly, trying to reduce the effectiveness of a killing machine which has helped put a high proportion of the 3,000 people into their cemeteries.
Despite a sense that he's now been forgotten by the authorities he once worked for, he still feels proud of what he's done.
I can honestly say my over four years with a Special Branch were the happiest days of my life. I worked with people who, from a young age, made me feel important, that treated us with a lot of respect, and I made, I mean, good friends with them. Tell me what job in the world that you can do where you can say to somebody, see that man over there? He's going to die somewhere, but I'm going to save him.
Good lad, thanks very much.
There's a heavy penalty to pay for such a brief career as a police agent. Martin McGartland is destined to a life on the run, always trying to keep one step ahead of the IRA. It may be his day in court was the last visit he'll ever make to Northern Ireland.
You can't go back. Basically, your life in Ireland has to be put behind you. You just have to, like, forget about Martin McGartland.